Welcome back. Another witness of how many lives were changed by ICTP. So just like the many that we already have listened to this morning, we go on celebrating 60 years of ICTP, a fresh start with this afternoon sessions, starting with the third panel, Global Science for Climate and Energy, that will be presented by the science journalist Danilo Zagaria.
Okay, so welcome back. Thank you, Roberta. And this is the third panel of this day of discussions and celebrations. And I would like to thank ICTP for organizing it and for asking me to moderate it. So I think that the title is quite clear, Global Science for Climate and Energy. I think it concerns one of the greatest challenges of this century for all humanity. So this panel will discuss the disconnect between what we need to do to reduce our carbon footprint and the current trend in energy consumption. So now we start with a brief introduction. I would like to call on stage a senior research scientist in ICTP's Earth System Physics section. Her current research activities focuses on the climate change impact on hazard at a regional scale by means of regional climate models and hydroclimate models. She had been author of the last assessment report 6 of IPCC, and she had coordinated the assessment of climate change impacts at the regional scale. So please welcome Erika Coppola.
Good afternoon, everybody. I am Erika Coppola. I am a scientist in the Earth System Physics section, and as my colleague before in the previous panel, I will introduce you what ICTP research has contributed in the past to this topic, what is going to contribute in the future, and how is this relevant in the, under the umbrella of the most important topic of research in the world. So, So the IPCC in the past has contributed to several research areas under the World Climate Research Program, for example, taking a leading role in initiatives like CORDEX, that is a Coordinated Regional Climate Downscaling. Thanks to his mandate, ICTP has facilitated the collaboration with a colleague, especially from the Global South, and the network that has been built within the ICTP corridor and wall has been playing a critical role for the contribution in many IPCC assessment reports, especially in the last one, the assessment report 6, in which we were able, together with our network of scientists in all over the world and especially in the Global South, to enrich the assessment with data, with scientific literature, but most overall, the contribution of numerous authors coming from the Global South and having a connection to the ICTP that has brought them to the attention to the IPCC. This resulted in a tremendous amount of literature production, assessment, and a step forward in this kind of report, and has now established an interactive atlas that is available permanently under the Copernicus project that is keep updating every year. What are we doing from there? So what are we want to do in the future? Of course, we want to keep addressing this regional climate research challenge. And what is asking us as a scientist is to go more to the very, very high resolution, to tackle problem, how is this storm affecting that region? Where is this storm forming? How intense it will be? Which part of the region will be affected by? And this we can only do if we use very high resolution dynamical model with a hierarchy of approach. And for going at such high resolution, of course, we started to look also at the contribution of artificial intelligence as in any other field. And we do this using what we call climate emulator. Why is this relevant? It's relevant because this will, going at such very fine scale, we will able to understand much more the physical process that we already understand now, but with the modeling system, we will enhance our understanding. And also we will be able to address the vulnerability and the adaptation problem that every region has under climate change. We will use this bottom-up approach that is usually used, as you have heard today, within the ICTP, because we will do research relevant for the specific region and together with the colleague coming from this region, with the researcher coming from this region. And also we will try to remove this data access barrier problem that is always struggling with what the region, especially in the global south, are always struggling because, as you may know, climate data is very heavy and difficult to handle. Why is this relevant? Because we all know that we have the need to reach this net zero target. And as you have been hearing here and there already, that 2024 was the hottest year on record so far. We are hitting the 1.5 threshold, and if we look at an update estimate of the global warming we have reached in this most recent year, we have been already getting closer to the 1.5. So we are 1.14 degree warmer compared to the pre-industrial period. If we look at the carbon budget that is remain to emit, if we stay with 1.5 threshold, the Paris Agreement threshold, with 83% of likelihood, we only have left 100 gigaton of CO2 to emit. And if we decrease the confidence likelihood, we go to the 50%, we are to the 250%, and we were just discussing that this is just 10% of what we have been emitting already in the past, so it's very, very tiny. And how can we do this? If we go back to what the IPCC tell us, we have way to do this, and of course we have to look at the way in which we produce energy. So these are different scenarios that have been coming out from the integrated assessment model. Integrated assessment model are macroeconomic models that study the evolution of energy production according to the published literature and what the state have put in their policy. So if we look at a scenario in which we do nothing, so we go with the current policy, then by the end of the century, we are going to hit the 4 degrees of global warming. If we look at a scenario in which we have a moderate action, so we don't reduce much the fossil fuel production, then we will hit the 3 degrees warming. If we want to reach the net zero and stay below the 1.5 degree, all the scenario below, you see the dominant color is the blue. So we have to move to alternative way of producing energy. And with this very complex and important problem, I let the panel discuss all the above.
So thank you very much. You were very, very clear. Now I present to you the three panelists of this section, starting with a climate scientist and professor at the University of Ghana and vice chair of the IPCC's Working Group 1 for the 7th assessment cycle. Please welcome Nana Ama Browne Klutse. The second one is the former Acting Secretary General and Director of the Research Division of OPEC and former Director General of the Kuwait Foundation for Advancement of Science. Please welcome Adnan Shihab-Eldin. Thank you. And the third one is a professor of physical chemistry at the Johannes Kepler University Linz, investigating organic semiconductors and their applications. So please welcome Serdar Niyazi Sarıçiftçi. I think we have little time to talk about very complex topics. So let's start immediately with the first round of questions. I will start with Professor Browne Klutse. And the question is, as a climate scientist and politician from Ghana, what do you see as the main challenges in creating and implementing policies that address climate change?
Thank you very much, and thanks to Erika for the introductory presentation. I think it sets the pace for our discussion as well. So I start with the scientist's point of view. I believe that as scientists, we have put out enough evidence that shows that we are treading on dangerous grounds now. We have explained how the climate system is it's going, the trends, and we have made some proposals of possible futures through the scenarios development. Coming from the IPCC point of view, we have produced enough, I would say, knowledge out there about the current condition that we are in. And I must put it here that the climate system is global. So one system or one process in one region affects the processes of climate in another region. So there's no region that is isolated. It can, the Arctic region processes affect systems all the way in the sub-Saharan Africa. And so we need to be concerned globally about the trends of events. So I'm bringing in the perspective of policy, hoping that very soon I'll get to the higher office of policy decisions or decision-making level. At the moment, what we're discussing is how policymakers will understand the situation, the current situation that we are in, and bring out the necessary decisions that will help adjust our activities, our actions as people towards especially cutting down of emission. Just coming from Baku, COP29, and we had discussions yesterday as well, I mean, since Monday, on what countries are doing. We come up with the nationally determined contributions. Countries come up with ways they are attempting or making effort to cut down the emissions through the actions and activities of each countries. I believe that we have not been ambitious enough in the effort to cut down our emission. I use the efforts globally we had put together to fight the COVID-19 pandemic compared to our efforts towards discussions on climate change. And I believe that all governments around the world are not doing enough. We have the capacity to cut the emission as much as possible that is expected so that we don't get to the tipping point, which we're discussing. But I believe that we are not doing enough. So from the policy point of view, I think we have not put in the necessary measures, the stringent effort that we need to put in to cut down the emission. So the science evidence is there, information is there, knowledge is there, but the policy side, I think we have not done enough or we are not doing enough. If you put in the same urgency that we did for COVID-19 pandemic, I believe we can do much better for the climate change and the emissions that we come up with.
Okay, thank you very much. So I pass to Professor Shihab-Eldin with a question that looks very simple, but it's not. How do we decarbonize when the world's energy needs are so high?
Well, first of all, let me take advantage of speaking on this to thank Atish for inviting me. And I say this because I was here first time 1975. Many of you were not even around the world at that time. But the spirit of this place had stayed with me since I met Professor Salam in 1975. We signed an agreement to support this place, so I'm very happy to be here with you. But let me turn to your question. I mean, we know, how do we decarbonize when we know that the world energy demand will continue to increase, and yet we have to go to net zero emission as soon as possible, perhaps 2050. The first thing we need to do, and everybody has recognized that, is the low-lying fruit. We have a low-lying fruit in energy efficiency technologies that have been tried and proven, especially in the North. So that technology has to be shared with the South, and it's being shared, but perhaps not at the speed required. So that's number one. Number two, we have to accelerate the deployment of low-carbon energy sources, including renewable. And we know for a fact that today, if you want to produce electricity when the sun is shining, the cheapest is solar energy. When the wind is blowing, it's probably wind. The problem is that these are diffuse and intermittent, and we have to find a system to overcome the intermittency and the diffuseness. And that means that we have to try all low carbon or low emission technologies, not focus only on one or two. And that's sort of the challenge as we move forward, because the other technologies, they may not be as cheap. Let's take nuclear, for example, compare it to photovoltaic. Nuclear is much more expensive. I'm a nuclear engineer by training and nuclear physicist. Nuclear is not cheap. But if you look at it in terms of a life cycle, 24 hours, 365 degrees, days, then it becomes comparable. So that the second thing is that we have to diversify all low-carbon technologies in our decarbonization. And I give here an example. Germany is known to be the best example of pushing low-carbon system, Energiewende. And yet, the cost of electricity in Germany today is one of the highest in the world. And that's because they haven't solved the problem of the system, because we know cost of electricity from solar photovoltaic is the cheapest when the sun is shining, but not system-wise. So I would say we need to decarbonize using all possible low-carbon energy system, and we need to kind of take knowledge that we are not equal in terms of our capacity, in terms of what we did to the environment, and what we need to move forward, because the developing countries need a lot of energy in the future. And if we don't make that recognition, we will not be able to reach our targets.
Okay, so thank you. So talking about solar energy, the next question is for Professor Sarıçiftçi. So the question is, do we have technologies advanced enough to tap into the full potential of solar power?
Thank you very much. Also, congratulations to ICTP from my side. I was here also in the 50th birthday, so it's indeed many, many years seeing old friends. So coming back to the technological question you asked, it is surprising that in the year of 2024, I received such a question. This is really interesting, because the first solar heater panels have been on the market, I'm not saying developed, on the market in 1890 in US. So you can heat up water very nicely, and this heat can be stored also overnight very nicely with solar heaters. It's one of the oldest technologies. And when I every time go to Africa and look around, I don't see any solar heaters on the roofs. So the technology is there over 100 years, but people don't use it. Today, combined with heat pumps, this would be the best source of heat you can ever get in the south. And it's not only cheap when the sun shines, you can store the hot water very nicely also over a period. The second is 1954, AT&T Bell Labs discovered the photovoltaics on silicon, even though it was a little bit earlier. But silicon solar cells have also a legacy which is 10 years older than ICTP. So the technology is there, and thanks also to Chinese investment in the 2000s, China made it possible to have a solar panel today which is approximately half a dollar per watt. This is an amazing price reduction. During my life, it was on the factor of around 70 to 100. This is amazing price reduction. The only other conversion which is missing on the line is the so-called solar to chemistry, what we call solar fields. And the people, even educated scientists, most of them don't think about this option, even though this is the reason why you are sitting and listening to me. This is called photosynthesis. Every time CO2 and water melts together with solar energy, you create very nice fuels, chemical compounds, gasolines, sugars, whatever you want. So artificial photosynthesis, first papers go back to 1920s. And many people are working. Even, I have to say, technologies like power to gas, e-fuels, all these technologies are available in large scale. So the question is not the technology is missing. Technology is out there. Technology is definitely ripe to be used. From other than technology or other than scientific reasons, it is not deployed.
Thank you. So I think it's time to consider the word global in the title of this session. So I return to Professor Browne Klutse. And the question is, what is the importance of ICTP creating a global climate community?
Thank you. I bring it in ICTP to me. I actually put myself out as an example of a product from ICTP as well. This was my first travel outside of Ghana, came to ICTP. And I came during my PhD on sandwich program. After my PhD, I got opportunity to also come in as a junior associate fellowship. So 10 years ago, I celebrated the 50th anniversary here as well. And I was a junior associate here. So I set up an example of ICTP because I have trained in ICTP, built the skills here, and I took it back home to train more capacity, and I've been involved in a lot of development of products, science, and not just in Ghana, also in Africa, and even at the global world where I now serve as vice chair of IPCC Working Group 1. I also contributed as a lead author in the CET assessments report. So I believe that for me as an example, and we've seen many stories in the documentaries, and we had one or two on the panelists as well talking about the impact the ICTP has made in their lives. I believe the ICTP is contributing a lot. There's still room for more. I believe there's the capacity for ICTP to do more. So not only focusing on the global north, but also concentrating a lot on the developing countries and global south is a very positive thing. Here is one ground where both the north and south meet, developing and developed meet. Early career scientists, students, older career scientists meet together to learn from each other. So it's already a community that is contributing at a global level. And I make a couple of proposals based on my earlier submission of the urgency that we need to put forward. Whilst we make efforts to mitigate, we make efforts to bring in the technologies that will help us to cut down emission and also meet our energy demands whilst probably contributing less. There's a growing discussion at the moment on climate intervention, because we have produced knowledge that shows also that even if we cut all our emissions of greenhouse gases today, the warming that is already in the atmosphere will continue for a couple of years before probably the atmosphere gets back to normal, maybe close to the pre-industrial level of emissions. So there's a new discussion, or growing, not really new, but it's growing interest of climate intervention, where solar radiation modification, carbon dioxide removal, and heat technologies are being discussed. The IPCC has also made it one of the discussion points coming up in the AR7. And I believe that once it's coming up, and then after scoping in December, it could probably be one of the topics to be assessed. We need to do research in these areas to understand what it means to solar radiation modification, what it means carbon dioxide removal. So if you intentionally remove some amount of carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, what are the implications? We need to understand how these new technologies or new ideas will inform the science and also affects the every other process in the atmosphere. So this is my proposal to ICTP. If scientists can also be looking at research in this area, it could purely be modeling work to understand, to some extent, what we do is typically modeling. So to understand how the direction we'll be going in terms of the interventions. So I feel doing this will help with the agency whilst we still, work towards the emission cuts. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So now I return to Professor Shihab-Eldin with another question about energy. So can you comment on the disconnect between what we need to do to reduce our carbon footprint and the current trend in energy consumption?
Well, I think that we have to recognize at the beginning that globally we need to reduce our carbon footprint until we reach net zero, hopefully by 2050 or 2060. But the world is not homogeneous in terms of development stage. If you look at energy consumption per capita in the north, and compare it to the south and some regions of the south, you might find a good part of the population of the world is consuming per capita less than one-tenth the energy consumption of the north. And second observation is that the north has been enjoying consumption at this high level per capita for almost 100 years, and mostly fossil fuels. It's only recently that renewables come in. What did that mean? That meant that industrial countries, and more recently China and some developing countries, have already placed into the atmosphere something like 2,500 gigatons of CO2, which is already causing about 1.3 degrees increase, if I'm not mistaken, according to one, something like this. I like to round numbers. I don't remember a precise number. So here is the disconnect. On the one hand, we need to move together to net zero emission, and we need to live on a carbon budget, as you have pointed out. If we want to not to exceed 1.5 degrees, we have only 250 at 50% confidence level. Let's take that number that you put out on the screen, which is about 10% of what we have already put into the atmosphere. Imagine as if we are all of us embarking on a journey on what I called metaphorically the environmental salvation ark of Noah. And we are going to move to 2050 when we will consume zero carbon. But we take with us about 250 gigatons, okay, for all of us. And we bring everybody with their luggage, legacy CO2, 2,500 on that ship, free of charge. That's the discrepancy. That is the problem. That's the crux of the problem. The developing countries are saying, okay, we will go along. We will live on this 250, and probably we will need to take most of it. That's the COP29, COP28 discussion. But please remember that you have already put about 2,000, if not. So the issue is how to solve this problem. And that's really the difficult part in this negotiation taking place in COP28, COP29. And my answer to that is that it's very simple. Either you take the approach of those who put the CO2 in the atmosphere, either they pay before they board, or they contribute to help everybody, or they develop the technologies and share it together. And let me just give you a number here, because I think it's important. You mentioned the carbon dioxide removal. If we remove 10% out of the 2,500 gigaton in the atmosphere, that's equal to doubling the carbon budget, right? That will allow some of the developing countries that are poor in energy consumption to make the journey, right? How much it does will cost? Currently, carbon dioxide removal technologies are about 1,000, but they're expected maybe they could go down with research and development and like especially direct air capture to somewhere between 100, 250. Let's take a nice number, 100. 100, to reach a gigaton, you need $100 billion per year. You know how much we spend on armament per year? $2.5 trillion in 23. $2.5 trillion in 23, 7% increase. And where does that go? To kill people. We are seeing people being killed, hundreds, 200 every day in the Middle East, in Sudan, in Ukraine. And so really we need to think about that. If we are willing to spend $2.5 trillion to allow people to be killed and we are numbed, we don't care. We just watch the TV. Or use maybe 1/10 of that to solve the environmental problem, to do carbon dioxide removal, to develop fusion energy, to develop low carbon technologies, all low carbon technologies, CCS, blue hydrogen, green hydrogen, pink hydrogen, all of these things. I think this is where the answer. The answer is that it's a political, not scientific. We know the scientific solution. The numbers are there. So my answer about this disconnect is that we need all kind of solutions. We need to really look hard at the facts and stop being numbed accepting pollution, stop being numbed accepting armament and using armament in civil wars and killing each other to the point that we don't even care what's happening to the people, and start looking at how can we divert resources that's going to destructing the environment, destructing people, and putting it in solving the problem equally. Remember, a new NFCC agreement was everybody is responsible, but there is differentiated responsibility. So that's the same thing as the spirit of Salaam here. The spirit of Salaam is that equity, but diversity. And that's the same thing applies to the environment.
Thank you. So talking about solution, we can return to Professor Sarıçiftçi with the last question of this panel. So how can solar energy become a bigger player in the global energy mix?
Well, this is, of course, a predictive question, and it's very difficult to answer because nobody knows what the future tells us. However, there are two aspects of it. One is the technological aspects. One is the so-called implementation. Technologically, one problem is already addressed. All renewable energies are supply-driven energy vectors. So that means the sun shines when it shines and not when we need it. The wind blows when it blows and not when we need it. So these supply-driven systems have to be added by the so-called storage. Energy storage is the key for entire renewable energy systems as we know today. How we store this energy is, of course, a technological challenge. You can use batteries, but it's too expensive and it will not live up to the famous terawatt challenge. There was this Nobel Prize, Rick Smalley, maybe some of you know him, knew him, he passed away. He got Nobel Prize for Chemistry in 1996. And he always said, we have this energy problem with terawatt challenge. So how to produce terawatts of energy and how to store terawatt hours of energy. So the batteries are definitely not living up to this. The only suggestion which we came up in the last decade is to convert the renewable energies into chemical energy, into gasoline, artificial gas, artificial gasoline, artificial energy carriers. They are chemical energy carriers. They are CO2 neutral because you take away the CO2 from the air, make these fuels, and when they burn, then they give exactly the same amount of CO2 back to the atmosphere. This is what we call circular CO2 economy. And these kind of things are there, and we can definitely go for it. Now, coming to the scale-up terawatt, it's difficult to scale up, for example, nuclear power. 100 gigawatt, when they do it in the next year, I would be more than surprised. But this year, as we are speaking, the solar production and installation in China was 500 gigawatt. I'm repeating, 500 gigawatt in 1 year, China and also the world has achieved. So this is solar energy is scalable. The political problem is in the economy. A solar panel, I have a solar panel system in my roof, needs a capex investment in the beginning. After the investment is there, this is more or less a cash machine for me. I have this financial power, I put this on my roof, I cut down the gas which I receive from the city. I don't pay for this gas anymore, and even in Austria, which is not very sunny, it pays off in around 11 years, completely. After 11 years, my entire energy system is for free, if it maintenance, maybe small and solar. So this is the point. The CapEx investment is the cost. And this CapEx investment has to be made ready by the banking system, by the financial system, to the people who need that. Production we have. China has enough production, don't worry. The money, the CapEx investment is there. The second biggest problem, it doesn't give you any profit. Because if you want to have a good solar energy price, you have to calculate very, very tight. So all the, let's say, oil-producing Middle Eastern Arab countries and Russia or whatever, they will be very unhappy. They will never go and invest, or the capitalist system will never invest in the solar energy in large scale, because the margin is so small. Therefore, the problem doesn't lie in the technology. The problem lies in the CapEx investment, how you force the capital to get into the system and make this CapEx investment in the beginning possible. This is my contribution, if I may say, with force, with the people sending the entire countries back to the Middle Ages. And by force, we will not secure any support from any country. We should give them this CapEx investment to make the solar energy and the storage, both of them, possible.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. More, yes, for one question. Okay, we have time for one question from the audience. Do we have Hani? Yes, right now we have the microphone. Okay.
I thank you very much for this discussion, but I go back to the topic of this roundtable: global science for climate and energy. The question is, how much science you still need? Because I'm seeing right in front of mine Euler's equation. So to discuss climate change, it's all there. The only problem is complex system, so you know that. And is there much science is still needed? And the reason I also ask that, because part of that I didn't enjoy very much, is to say that you have to transfer knowledge and technology to the South. There is plenty of knowledge in the South. If you talk about tropical forests, Brazil knows more than anybody else in the north. We know how to do that. And the other problem with solar energy is through the panels, but the problem in the south is smart grids. So we have to have grids that can transfer energy from one side to the other, and very, very modern electronics. China is dominating now 90% of the production of inverters and batteries. So it's not a question of, knowledge and science. It's a question of how to plan that. And also we have to remember that different countries in the south have different electrical systems. So talking about the global solutions is too naive, in my opinion. You have to look into details of each region, of each country, and that may be ICTP can help on that.
So I think one relevant key question is, what else do we need to know? We need to estimate how much this, if we think, how much is this impacting the climate and the system in each of the country. You know well your forest, but if you do not have enough model telling you what will be the damage, the uncertainty of the damage, you will never be able to convince the policymaker that they have to do something, because the cost that you will pay for the damage that you receive every year, multiple times, will be much higher than the cost of the transition to the green energy. I think this is the science that is still needed. I mean, we are working on that to give you details, information, to increase the knowledge we have as a scientist to say that these are the consequences if we don't do not. This will be the impact that you will have. And I think this is the key question to answer, because without this, you will never be able to convince anybody that it's better to invest in the transition.
Yeah, I think you're right, because there is a lot of research that's needed that depends on science, not just pure science. Pure science is needed, but you mentioned, like, currently, the cost of carbon dioxide removal is $1,000 per ton. How do we bring it to 100? There is a lot of science and technology goes into that. So we still need a lot of fusion. Well, I remember when I was in college in Berkeley trying to get my PhD in 1965, they told me fusion will be around in 30 years. And now they tell me it's in about 20 years. After 50 years. So we still need to do a lot of research. Fusion is very promising, so we need to invest in that. And we need to invest in research in all of the technologies. We cannot put all of our eggs in the solar basket. We have to put all of our eggs diversifying them. So I would advocate that ICTP in particular should get involved in promoting research in the various aspects of reaching that system. And you pointed out correctly, not only hard sciences, we need to do economics to convince the people that the cost of not doing anything will cost us 10% of our GDP down the line. That's study. We have to do more of that. 10% of our GDP, the world GDP, just figure out how much 10%. Maybe it's 9%, maybe it's 11%. But that cost is very high. If we can convince the people to invest 1/10 of that, we can solve the problem.
I have to repeat my standard answer to you. I'm a big fan of nuclear fusion. I'm really the biggest fan of nuclear fusion. The only difference between you and me is I'm very happy where it is right now. It's 150,000 miles away from us. It works perfectly. It will work for a long time perfectly. I take just the energy, and I don't need it here. Thank you.
Okay. So, a few words to support the question and the discussion. So, a simple scenario. So, so in all of these efforts, we know that we are already experiencing the impact of climate change, and so we need to also, have adaptation strategy, and then it comes to the cost of adaptation. As we speak, we have sea level rise causing coastal erosion. And if you look at some of the pictures, it's so devastating for the coastal communities. And it all traces back to the melting of the ice in the Arctic and Antarctic region. And it's because of global warming. So those in that habitat losing their livelihood, losing their culture, losing a lot of what they actually relate to. And that is affecting all the way down to coastal communities. If you see pictures from Ghana, from West Africa, it's so pathetic that houses that used to be very far away, kilometers away from the ocean, are now in the ocean and then destroying properties. So the cost, even now, is high. And then if you project how much more devastation we are going to have in future, will triple the costs of adaptation. So doing the economics as well would probably help as probably the first question on what policymakers are doing. I believe we can do better than what we are doing now. We have to be more strategic and then see the urgency of where to go from here. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you. So I think we don't have time for any more questions. So I thank the four guests of this panel for participating and answering the question, and I wish you all a good continuation of this day. Thank you very much. Thank you.